Our video presenters today will be Vicki prepping her work here. And Phil, who seems to be all set and waiting for us. Okay. Our demonstrators will be Vicki Pollack and hand building and Phil Falcone and hand building techniques.
This is like in Seca where they do two demonstrations at once.
We're talking about using TarPaper, and for anybody that doesn't know, it's this black stuff that comes in big rolls. You could get it at Home Depot, Lowe's, your local True Value hardware store, or whatever. And I use the heavier paper. It comes in two weights, 30 pound and 15 pound. I use the heavier one because it's a little stiffer. And this is what we're using for our demonstrations. For me, I use it for primarily three reasons. One, as you'll see in a few minutes, when you roll your clay out with this adhered to it, it gives you some stiffness so you could handle your pieces. Secondly, again, I'm a guy that likes to keep going, so I hate to think about a project to start rolling out the clay, start cutting it out, and then have to wait for it to dry. I like to keep going. What this allows me to do, as you're going to see later in the demonstration, is you can go through the process, pick it up, and start assembling right away. And then if you have something that's got narrow elements to it and you need a little bit of support, then the paper helps you to get that support. So those are the primary reasons that I use it. I have a number of samples here. These samples ended up making this piece. Now, if you want to have a consistent design on multiple pieces, if you take your template, you can start cutting those lines, put the little dot in there. When you roll it out, that imprint is going to come out. So you've got the basis for doing your cuts. Then you just have to line it up and make the cuts.
So what do you do? Make the design in the template itself?
Make it right in the template. You could just, now I've done it both ways. You could just make a single cut with, you know, a razor knife. If you want a wider piece, I've made, you know, double cuts so that you get that thickness coming out. And then for pieces, for those of you that, you know, have seen my trucks, this way of doing hand building is invaluable for doing the trucks, because then all of the windows and all of the little elements I can cut out of here, and what I'll do is I will almost complete a window cutout, roll it out, and then I've got that mark on the clay from the template. And then when I assemble it, at times I will then go, after it has time to dry for a day or two, take my X-Acto knife and go and cut it out with this still adhered, and you get a nice clean cut. So that's the why of it. Vic, now, how you do it, just grab a piece of the paper, draw whatever you want. You know, in this case, I have a model that I'm going to be cutting out and putting together right here, and a little bit of preparation for it. I've also gone through, and yesterday afternoon, I did three of the pieces, so they're right here. The fourth one I'm going to do right here at the meeting while Vicki is talking, and then we'll attempt to assemble this in a few minutes.
Can I
But you don't have to be.
Two very different approaches.
This is very simple. I mean, you know, anybody can do this. I mean, my grandkids, if I let them, will do this. Got it right and the left. So, you know, nothing complicated about how you do that.
I'm a lot more loose, and I'm a lot more clumsy. So a lot of my things are, you know, kind of have great texture in them. I really love the tar paper because it does provide the support. You can use it for very wet clay as well as drier clay. You can roll it out, you can put your tar paper patterns on, and you can let it set up. I teach. It's wonderful with students, with kids. And it's very, it's a lot of fun to put together. It's kind of like putting a puzzle together. So while Phil is rolling out, I just wanted to give a quick demo of what I do to how I roll out the tar paper on the clay.
You also use the stiffer version?
Yes. Yeah. I like. It's also great for making patterns if you're cutting something out repeatedly. Mm-hmm. It's really sturdy. So I roll out my clay. I think this is about 3/8. And then, you know, you do the whole compression thing. I'm also going to throw some, I brought some of my favorite tools with me and techniques. And one of the things I love to use is the interfacing material.
Can I ask a question about the compressing that you do and what the purpose of that is? Is that to help prevent warping? Or?
Yeah, it compresses all the little platelets of clay and everything you've ever read about, how to prevent warping. And it does not thin it out very much. I like it a little bit thicker. You know, I like working heavy. To me, a heavy pot is not a bad pot. A heavy mug might be. But so you want to do the compression and the smoothing. It also smooths out if you used a canvas. Yeah, smooths out the texture. But you see, I use the Pellon to flip it over, and that's a really good thing to do because it holds it in place. So picking it up, you know, bad. It stretches, yeah. So that's a nightmare.
That's a great
so
nightmare.
The whole process of using this,
you can even
and flipping
use that
it.
Roller.
Pardon?
You can use that through the roller.
Right, you can, yeah.
What is that material?
Pellon. It's interfacing. You can buy it at a fabric store. Make sure you get the one that is not the iron on, because that has junk in it, yes. Okay.
Yeah, another plastic bags.
Yeah.
It works. But
you know,
like
everybody, you go through one thing that has to be done, there'll be 50 different ways of doing it. Now, I did not texture this, but you can texture, oops, a little wet. You can texture it before you roll out your patterns. And this is just a tube I made in Bisset. So if you're doing a texture, you want to wet your tar paper. If you're not, what you can do is directly wet the clay and then put your patterns on top. It's good to lay out your patterns ahead of time so you get a sense of, you know, how much space you need. Do not put the patterns right next to each other. Give yourself at least a quarter of an inch space in between. And then you're going to roll it and give it a good roll. You want to push the tar paper down into the clay. And this adheres it because you want the tar paper to stay on the clay. You're not going to peel it off until you're virtually done.
Even the textured one.
Yeah, it'll flatten it a little bit, so you want to give it a good hard texture, a good hard impression. And when I cut, I use the form as my guide, and you take it beyond the corner. For those of you who've ever cut mats, you know that you don't stop right at the corner, because then your corner's going to pull when you're trying to separate it. So you
are
go
you
just...
out of 45 there? Is that when
yeah.
You're
Yeah,
okay.
Pretty much. Thank you. And what I like to do with this, is peel off the clay around it and remove it. You don't want to, you want to have your piece free to lift up. So these I'm just doing to show you how to cut. I'm not using these. And to give you the idea.
Would you normally work that soft?
You can. You can. It depends on, you know,
what
how
happens.
Far ahead of time, you know, what your schedule is, how quickly you get into the studio. So when you've cleared away the clay around it, you can either lift it with the pal on or just easily peel it off, so you don't want to stretch.
Okay.
And then what I do, and it's very important if you're using different shapes and sizes that have to fit together, is you want to lay them out so you know how they're going to come together. Because, oh God, do I get confused. And I actually made a mistake today, because you want your beveling, you want your pieces to all go together. And there have been times, and I made a mistake this morning attaching this. I did it on the wrong side, which was really dramatic.
So you mean lay them out like a,
so
one of those exploding diagram
the way,
kind of things?
The way you're going, this is going to go together. Just okay. Flip it up, and that way you know how your bevels have to be cut.
Okay, thank you.
So that to me is critical and probably something that I don't pay enough attention to. This is gadget number two, I suppose, the beveling tool. It comes with two angles. I have never used this angle. I guess one of these days I'll try it out. I guess that's about a 60?
30-60.
And this is a 45. That's what you want.
If you do something other than a four-sided figure, that other angle will come into play.
Thank you,
very slowly along the edge of the,
sorry,
the tar paper. Use your tar paper as your guide.
That's,
and again, you start off a little bit from the corner, you line it up, and you very slowly. One of the things you got to be careful of is what's underneath here, because if there's a crinkle in the paper or newspaper underneath it, it will affect your cut. I have seen people in videos take a knife and go zip, zip, zip. I can't do that. Yeah, they can cut the angle with a knife, but that's why I love this tool. Look at that. Look at how lovely that is.
Beautiful.
Now, don't get rid of these little pieces. You're going to use...
In 1 second, Rob, who did make that tool?
This might be Dirty Girls.
Ceramics.
But there are a number of different ones.
Right. I like
this one.
It doesn't have the nice little turnbuckle.
Yeah.
What is that turnbuckle?
Keeps it
tightens
the wires.
Yeah. Oh, and you got that from
Ceramic Supply.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Dirty Girls. I think Dirty Girl Tools.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I just took that template that you saw me, you know, cut out, went over to the slab roller. I rolled it out to 1/4 inch. What I do is I roll the clay through, fold the canvas over, put my template on, and roll it back. And I've never had a problem with it not sticking or not coming out the way I want.
So no water involved.
No water involved.
I don't know, Vicki.
Okay, and now, unlike I do the same thing that Vicki just did, mine's homemade, but it does the same thing, and so you just go through, and one of the advantages, that paper is stiff enough that it doesn't take a lot of pressure. You can just put this right against it and trace it, and it'll follow through.
Is that a homemade wire cutter?
This is a homemade one.
By an engineer, though.
So
keep that in mind.
It doesn't take a lot. I mean, all you have to do is simple geometry. This has to be the same one.
Too that. Much right there.
Coffee right there.
You know?
Yes.
What's the
cosine
of that?
All right. Now, Bill, you're getting me, because I've been past that long enough that I don't remember that. I'd have to go look it up. Okay. So are you going to start assembling, Vicki?
Sure. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Ooh, so these are the pieces that I carved off when I made my templates, my cuts. And I keep them damp because you want them to be nice and moist, and boy, do these dry out quickly, especially in a basement where you have the furnaces running in the winter. Mm-hmm. The temperature's about 90 degrees, I think.
You're not running the kiln either.
Yeah, well. So I'm a slipper scorer, even though the clay may be moist. I do like to be sure. And I do find that there can be tension drying, you know, on the corners. And also, I brought a couple of pieces with me that I've done. And this one in particular was done in a soda firing, so it was high temperature. And I had a couple of pieces where the seams did separate. So I'll do everything I can to try and make sure that doesn't happen.
Do you grog your clay, or is it grog?
It's this happens to be ceramic 112. I do very little. I take it out of the bag. I don't wedge if I can help it, and I use it as is.
No grog.
No grog.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So even with the tar paper attached to your slabs in the drying, it still pulls away a little at the corner, you think?
No.
Oh,
no.
You're
also going to construct pretty quickly.
Okay.
So
do you have anything in your slip?
No, it's just water in the clay.
Okay.
I'm sorry, do you ask that? Yeah.
Talking about the drying, I've let my assembled piece sit overnight sometimes. But you don't want it to sit too long because the side that doesn't have the paper is going to be drying and you start to get bowing.
Oh, okay.
And so you want to try and get that off as soon as you can so that you don't end up with a distorted piece.
Okay, thank you.
Great having two different approaches. So, lining this up, you just lift it and hold it together, and the two tar paper pieces, you know, should line right up to each other. And then I take this, it's nice and wet, so I'm not going to slip that. And it goes right into the groove.
That's a great idea.
And it's nice and soft,
I've never done that.
So I can, that purely happened by accident. This, I was doing coils, and then one day I looked at that, and
why make a coil when you go
really?
The same
really?
Thing. I'm not going to use it here, but I had the same realization. I mean, you're doing this, and you're rolling these coils, to sit, and then all of a sudden you're saying, look at what I've got here. It goes right in
perfect.
There.
Perfect. It's like, it fits exactly. Go ahead, talk.
Okay, well, we're doing the same thing.
Okay.
Now, different tools. You know, I use one of these little things for my scoring.
Michael,
by the
Cheryl.
Way, do you know that they charge you an extra buck if you buy that tool with the bent prongs? Right?
Yes, I do know that.
Yes. Be aware, you can go like this.
Cool, so there you go. That might be a topic for another day.
Speaking of wine corks, for you throwers, I saw somebody had attached your chamois, mm-hmm. attached the chamois to a wine cork.
Yes.
So it was exactly the same thing in your bucket.
So you don't wind up.
And I was like, if I were a thrower, that would be awesome.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah.
So one of the nice things about using this also is because of this shape, all you have to do really is to take your finger and run it in, and it does not take a lot of manipulation, except when you break it off. And
so excuse me, so your slip doesn't have any kind of anything else except just
water and clay.
Got it. Okay.
So this gets to be fun as your piece comes together and your opening gets smaller and smaller.
Yep. Like painting yourself in the corner of a room.
Yeah.
This is 182.
It's a Picasso-like pot.
That would be cool.
Well, you know, great things have come from.
You know, have you ever put the other two together and then put them together? That's the way I'm
doing it. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. And so you have to like put them in the middle and then the back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
Because that's the way I've always done it.
You only have to then wiggle
one piece in there. So, because there's
it might be a stronger corner.
See how you learn from students all the time.
I like them to see it. See
and mistakes.
Best thing about
students and mistakes. Now, on this particular one, you probably noticed that I put a niche on it. So I had cut a hole in it. And I put a box behind it. So
yeah, that's interesting. You have a plan for that, I guess.
Well, that is kind of this concept. But this one, I didn't put a box behind, so you just see the wall behind it.
Yeah.
Oh,
isn't that pretty?
And,
Nice. Wow. Interesting. Oh, I thought you were saying that you did it accidentally.
Well, what I did accidentally is when I put it on,
yeah.
I put it on the wrong side of the slab.
But you had fixed it by the time you were telling us.
I was trying to fix it,
okay.
Yeah. So it's my edges are not going to line up the way I would like them to. So here comes the tricky part, getting your hand in
That's
there.
That's the non-engineer part?
Yeah. How's he doing over there? Oh, look, are you watching his curves?
Okay, Phil, talk.
Okay, so
I think cute.
With the curved end there, I let it go a little bit longer because then I can cut that off exactly. If I were doing straight pieces, then I cut it directly with the template. So we're doing the same thing here, just putting it all together.
Wouldn't it be easier if you now...
Maybe we will forget
it. Is that a drumstick?
Probably.
It's a drumstick.
It's a tool.
Oh, it looks like.
Does that have a phone?
It could have a phone.
Yeah.
If your son has left his drumsticks around, they're fair game.
There you go.
Everything's fair game.
Everything's fair game.
You never come back again.
It would be a curse.
Funny, you said drumstick. I was thinking of a chicken bone.
Oh,
true.
Yeah.
Different reaction.
Thank you for helping me out with that coil.
In between the two slabs there. What do? Do they keep the thing from
now this thing
pushing
here?
Together? Yeah.
No, that's an opening I've made in it, and it's a little box.
I've yet to look at what it looks like. Okay.
Yes.
So when the tar paper comes off?
Right.
When
the tar paper comes off, this has been cut out.
Yes.
Oh,
that's cool.
It's a box.
I get it when I saw it. I get it now. It's great.
I should have mentioned that earlier, where you want to put it in.
Yes.
Or on that also.
Around all four edges?
Three. This top part separate.
Oh, yeah, that's what I meant by that.
Or you could put it on the piece you're connecting.
You
could put it there, too.
There are a number of ways.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, and you're never going to see inside this piece. So
okay.
It's not critical. Yeah. But you do want the good joint.
That is what's so great about that for students is that you get somebody rolling at a slab and they don't have time to let it dry enough to handle, and then they're cutting slabs out maybe a week ahead or,
And I have wrapped them, even though, as Phil said, this does have a tendency to draw the moisture out of the clay. But I do wrap them in plastic, and they'll stay soft for a while.
Do you think that the other kind, the lighter kind of paper would be as good or not?
Well, I don't think it gives you as much support.
I have a whole roll of it.
I'll try it.
Glue it together.
Another inexpensive forms that you can use for templates is the half-gallon juice or milk containers. I used to use that with my students.
So there's no problem with that.
No.
We don't use milk.
Well, juice. One of my students just came.
Well, the kids used to bring them from home. Yeah.
To cut them and they're there.
I am impressed.
Look at this.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Cute.
Yeah.
American Except I gotta put a top on mine.
What is it? Top on?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Throw down.
Throw down.
The bump.
The bump.
Yes.
I don't like
that. I don't know what this is made. Wet it. It's like.
Are you, you're talking about a Cheryl Mud tool called the bump?
Is that what this is? Yes.
Yeah. I'm just doing that for the video.
Thank you.
That is what it is.
What is it called? Where did you get
the bump? There's one that comes with a hook. Right. So you can fit it inside a pot.
You can curve that. It's stem.
Can't you? Yeah.
You can bend that.
I don't know. Mine looks pretty stiff.
Oh, yeah. Mine can be bent.
It's pretty
mine can be bent.
I'm sorry.
But they do sell them bent and straight and bigger.
And they charge you more for being able to bend it.
let's not mock Michael, Cheryl. For
no.
Sorry.
He's quite brilliant.
He has revolutionized.
And clearly when you do this and firm up your corners, you make sure that you've got support on the other side of the pressure. Yeah, you push it right out.
See, this is the teacher versus the engineer. Engineer, chat.
Yes, well, I'm doing the same thing, and you see I have my fingers on the other side over here. So I'm following the teacher's advice.
You just hope for the best in the parts you can't reach?
Well, this was a case where if I thought about it ahead of time, those little strips we would have cut off, this is the ideal place to put them on that last one. Mm-hmm, yeah. And then all you have to do is reach in. But considering that I was not thinking and I rolled it up,
we're distracting.
Then we're just going to let it go for here.
It's a little bit different than working in your studio quietly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that is the time to adhere.
Anxiety too.
Yeah.
You guys are doing great.
I was telling Phil that I was a teacher for a number of years, and I was a puppeteer. So I'm used to performing in front of people. I said, I am so nervous today. I can't believe it. Because they're all potters watching me pot.
Well, I've learned something, so I'm not watching you with a critical eye.
Okay.
I'm
going to
learn.
No,
this was great.
I think
really
also
really
hearing
really
your comments is also wonderful for us, me, who work alone in our studios.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry, I'm trying to.
Just want to clean up inside a little bit what I can
see. Creativity level goes up when you work among
it. It
does. Where do you purchase this tool?
Ceramic supply, any ceramic place. The bump. Also, I haven't. I guess it's kind of. I like all the. The clay, is it the clay studio in Philadelphia? What's the name of the
ceramic
shop?
Yeah.
They have, I think, a better selection.
Yeah. Thank you. Although they have prices on anything when you get there. So just,
they what?
They have no prices on anything when you get there. If you don't know online,
never been there.
Then I go there.
Who?
Clay, CLAY-KING. They are.
Right now,
it's
just a couple hours.
And
I'm taking it off a little sooner than I would normally, just to show that you can take it off.
Phil's doing his big reveal, guys.
Okay. I'm taking this off sooner than I would normally, but that's just to show you that it can be done. Yeah, normally I would let this sit a couple hours in the studio before I do this. And then, you know, afterwards you could take your lid and you could smooth it out and do all that kind of good stuff.
Now the top on mine, fits right on top, one hopes. If it's a little larger, I can take care of that. Bigger is good, smaller is not.
You're not angling the edges on this?
No, because I want it to sit right on top. And this is probably the... And this got a little bit drier than I would have liked.
Flush.
But this is where the tar paper really comes in handy because it's supporting this clay and it just doesn't sag again.
That's wonderful.
So,
How big of a bowl is this tar paper on
You can do your whole roof.
Or when you have your roof done, say to the roofer, could you leave some?
You know, if you know any roofers, and say, I'll take the scrap.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Well, you or buy you one roll and split it between 20 people.
Like. Or if there's a roof being done in your neighborhood.
Right.
I use the pony roller to compress and to press on down on the seam.
And you can do that.
Yeah. And I'm going to take it apart as well so you can kind of see. But
now,
go ahead, Phil.
Well, I was going to say, if you don't look too close, because that piece that I just rolled, I really should have let it set a little bit longer. So you'll see that, you know, it starts to pull apart. But I think it demonstrates that, you know, you can do it pretty quickly. So typically, I'm running, you know, half a dozen at a time. So if you're going through that process, you could set this aside, do the next one, set it aside. After a couple hours, when you strip it, then you're in pretty good shape, you know, but that's, you know.
Now, I'm looking at that thinking, oh, I could push it a little this way.
Oh, yeah. Exactly, you know.
Yeah, it's soft. But
it's like, soft.
If you need it to set up just right, you do need to
let it sit a bit.
Yeah. How is it with flexing with the clay on it? Like, if you wanted to have a turn, like, say, a little bit of a twist at the top, if you left the paper on it, would you be able to manipulate it enough to twist?
If you could take the piece of paper and twist it.
Can you do that?
Then you could do that. Okay. All right. Now, it presents a bit of a problem in terms of what you're adhering it to if you're going to adhere it.
But I was saying, after you have it all together, you have all four sides with the paper on it, you can still twist it together. And then as it sets up, then you can take it off. So
I did a piece that was bent in two ways. It came down like that, and then on the side, it came down like that. That was difficult because you had to support that. If it only turned in the one direction, that becomes easy. Once you go to the other direction, you still have to support it a bit as you're taking it apart.
Well, any hand building, you still have to support
Working. But it, you know, it can be done. It's just.
What about the seams popping when you do that?
If you let it dry. The fact that it's still so wet.
Right. Right.
You know, it's creating an issue.
I was just going to ask, how dry can it get before you take the tar? Can tar paper just get so that it will fall off?
No.
If you want your side that the tar paper, if you wanted to bow, you could let it do that. But it'll definitely, the side without the tar paper is going to dry quicker than the other side. Now,
how many times can you reuse the tar paper?
I've read up to 20. I've only reused them 6-8 times.
Wow.
You know,
Sometimes you start getting texture in them, don't you?
Yeah. I mean, typically something like this, if it gets really dirty, I'll just take a wet sponge and wipe it off.
I can't clean it.
Vicki mentioned earlier, gee, sometimes they start to curl on her. What I do when that starts to happen is I take a couple boards and I let them dry and just,
You can wait until it gets nice and firm. And it can almost stand up on its own at that point. But, you know, you can work it in many different drynesses, which really makes it wonderful for people who can't get down into their studio at exactly a precise moment. And, again, for kids. Once you take it off, too, there's corner cleanup. You know, you want to do whatever you can to make it look the way you want it to look. So, and it's funny because I even like the way this extends a little bit over the top.
Yeah. Do you have any particular tool you use for the corners?
I brought something, but I don't always use it. It's this little thing that rounds corners.
Nice.
And that works very nicely.
Where did you get that?
Same ceramic place. All your ceramic supply and the place in Philly online, you know, They pretty much, I don't even know what the name of this is or who makes it. Is that the Oriental Tools? Do they make this?
Mm-hmm.
They might.
Can we pass that around? Pass it around.
There's a little bridge that's been soldered in. It's not even a wire, but it's a tool.
And then I will do more. I like boxes, but I don't always like the fact that they look so squared off. So I'll drape them, you know, with a soft slab of clay. On this one, I added a thin slab that I textured and patterned, and I wrapped it around and attached that. This pot, this is bird seed. Bird seed was impressed into the clay. And
did you fire it? Did you fire the bird seed in the kiln?
Yes, I got to tell you the story about that.
I'd like to hear that.
If you have an electric kiln in your house,
don't.
Okay. I don't know what I was thinking. Clearly, I wasn't, because I put it in the kiln, and that was before I had my venting system even. Turned it on, went upstairs, and about an hour later, all the smoke alarms are going off in the house. And I run downstairs and the smoke pouring out of the kiln. Of course, the bird seed is burning. So I took it out, closed everything down, took it up to Peter's Valley. He'll fire anything.
Yeah.
I got a fire there.
So what? He's corn, you're not popcorn.
Oh, at least
the smoke
the fired. Beyond the box, beyond the square, beyond, you know, whatever, you can carve designs, you can do all sorts of things. Another thing I thought of as you were talking about that was using hot glue for design on the tar paper. The sky is the limit. I mean, there is so much you can do with this.
Well, you can also put it on the mantle.
This was great. And also at times I've taken the hair dryer, you know, and I've used it on the piece if I'm in a hurry. So that, I mean, you can see this is really too soft to stay, but you get the idea.
Thank you.
Thank you.